So hi, thanks for coming out. My name is Matt Gifford. I'm one of the organizers of Mobile Portland. How many of you, it's your first time at one of our meetings? So I have maybe more, which is evil. Okay, so because we have so many new people, we go through this every time. I'm sorry, it's boring. So we're about mobile, obviously. We meet the fourth Monday of every month. Monday because of Mobile Mondays, which is an international organization that we're actually not affiliated with. The website is mobileportland.com. We have Google Group. I'm not going to figure that out. You can figure that out. We also have a mailing list that you can sign up at the website. It's just, if you don't want all the traffic of the Google Group, just sign up for the mailing list. It's two or three announcements basically about this meeting. And we also have a Twitter account at Mobile Portland. So upcoming events, we're kind of through the big conferences, so there's not much here tonight. And then we have our August meeting. In August, there's Visual Studio Live in Redmond, and we've actually been given a discount code. If you're interested in going, it's UGVR16, and it's in the Google group. There's an email about it as well. That code will give you $500 off. So there's some groups that are kind of might be of interest to some of you in the area. There's Kaiku, Android enthusiasts, Cocoa Heads, and Portland JavaScript admirers. If you're part of a group that you think other people here might be interested in, just let us know and you can add it to the list. And now, I'll just go around with the mic. If anybody has an announcement about a job opening or some project that needs somebody on or something that you think might be of interest to anybody, just raise your hand and I'll come around.
Hi, my name is Willie Sierra. I'm with Azad. We're an IT consulting company where we hire all of our engineers directly for our company to deploy them on long-term projects and redeploy them and retain our employees for multiple consecutive long-term projects. And right now I'm hiring an iOS developer to join our firm. It's working within an educational space, developing an educational iOS app for technical end users. I'd be more than happy to speak with any of you about this opportunity or anything else about our company or what you're looking for in the future. I'll be probably in this area afterwards, so feel free to go find me.
Hi, my name is Clint. I make marketing videos for apps and startups. I'm moving to Portland, but don't have a job, so I'm offering $1,500 of free video marketing work in exchange for a really reliable job lead anywhere in the city, doesn't matter what it is. I grew up in starting law school and I just want to move here. So I'm just finishing up a set of videos for a funding startup in Seattle. It's very high quality work and very strong branding and messaging. So if anyone's interested, I have a pad for contact info. Thank you.
Hey everybody, I'm Dave from Crowd Compass. Mobile company here that makes apps for events, so live events, trade shows, conferences, and we're hiring pretty much for all positions. So we're growing a lot. We're hiring mobile devs, mobile web folks, client services folks, customer care folks, QA. So yeah, all positions. Yeah.
I'm Grant Mulholt, I'm with Gundog Labs, a startup here in Portland. We're looking for Android and iOS developers for near-field communication applications here, NFC. If you don't know what that is, then definitely come see me, especially if you're an Android or iOS developer. Yeah, come see me.
My name is John Gooden. And I am on board advisors for a startup company called AutoApp, and it's building an app that's in the automobile space. There's some serious execution in the automobile industry that are involved in this, and we're looking for a development firm or individuals that are interested in doing development. So if you're interested, please contact me this afternoon.
Thanks to our sponsors. Urbanership, I don't know if there's anybody here to talk. Last time I checked, they have a lot of job openings, so if you're looking for work, that would be a place to look. And thanks to Cloud4. Jason, did you want to say anything? Nope. Okay, so those are our sponsors. Thank you very much. And so this month, we're talking about apps for coffee farmers. And the practical lessons to be learned from doing that kind of work. Our speaker this month is Ezra Spear. He's the Director of Technology Solutions for Sustainable Harvest, and I think he's going to explain what they do.
Expect lots of good questions from everybody. So sustainable harvest is a coffee importer. What that means is that we buy green unroasted coffee. So that's coffee that's been grown but hasn't been roasted yet. And we sell that coffee to coffee roasters in North America and Europe. And we're based here in Portland. We have about 40 employees. But we also have origin offices around the world in Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Tanzania. So it's a really international kind of working place. About half our employees are abroad. The general way that coffee moves around the world is sort of like this. So coffee farmers who usually own a sort of small amount of land will grow the coffee, pick it, and sell it to coffee cooperatives, who then sell it to coffee exporters, who then sell it to coffee importers at the sustainable harvest, and then sell it to roasters who sell it to a bunch of coffee. The problem with this sort of traditional setup in the supply chain is that most of the actors in this chain are approaching all the work they do as sort of a series of short-term transactions. So, you know, just trying to sell the beans that they have, you know, sort of buying low, selling high, especially in the case of the world. But looking at everything as a series of short-term transactions can have some serious implications, because if you're only looking short-term, you're not thinking about the cost for the environment or the cost in the communities. So sustainable harvest, we think there's a different way. And we call this way relationship coffee. So in sustainable harvest, we transform the way that we do business by investing in long-term relationships that are rooted in transparency and trust. We call this the dolphin slide. Basically, by investing in transparency and investing in trust, we'll be able to create a thriving business for everybody involved. So when we benefit as an importer, coffee growers benefit as well. And retail to benefit. And so by creating a really positive sort of feedback loop, we're able to really impact entire communities. And that's really what we're set up to do. We're a for-profit company, but we exist to realize the farmers around the world. So what does that mean in practice? Well, it means that coffee growers that we work with have a chance to meet the people that are actually buying the coffee. Every grower that we work with knows who's buying our coffee, and everybody who buys coffee from us knows where it's coming from. There's no opaqueness, we're completely transparent. We'll even talk about how much money we make so they know we're not pricing that kind of thing. We reinvest a third of our earnings into training projects. This is a fertilizer plant in northern Peru that the Torinos Cooperative is using to really increase their productivity so that they can sell their coffee and sell their quality. We also focus on trying to find ways to empower coffee producers to sort of compete in the global marketplace. And one way to do that is with quality control. So most people that grow coffee don't actually drink their own coffee. And even worse, they don't even know how their coffee is being judged by the final buyers. So by bringing expert quality control training to the people that are growing coffee, they can see how good of a quality their product actually is. So maybe they can argue for a better price. Maybe they can sort of learn more about what work they can do to increase their quality. And having that knowledge is incredibly critical. So that's sort of where we like to focus our efforts. And it's been incredibly successful for us. This is our sort of growth slide. We've grown 41% annually since 1997 when we were founded. We have some of the best customers in the business, like Green Mountain Coffee in Vermont, Whole Foods, Pete's. And we actually do the coffee that goes into the Jerry's ice cream. But when we look at the slide, we don't see the dollar signs. What we see is the fact that we're able to help more farmers around the world. And that to us is the most meaningful part of this. But anyway, I'm here to talk about technology. And you might ask, so what does a coffee importer have to do with technology at all? Why would you even think about this as being relevant? And for us, it actually can be natural. As we grew, we realized there's a lot of details that go into importing coffee. So we had to build internally a number of systems to keep track of all the data. So, you know, what coffee is coming from who, when is it shipping, what boat is it on, what's the quality of it, all those kinds of minutiae are really important. And so as we internally started building our own system, we sort of took a step back as we're doing farmer trainings around the world and thinking, well, hey, this technology has helped us a lot. It will help the people that we're trying to help too. So that was sort of the beginning of how we looked at tech. We just see it as another tool in our arsenal to help have a positive impact in the communities. What I'm going to do now is play you a short video. It's about 5 minutes. I think it will give you some of the, sort of the visuals, show you, introduce you to some of the apps that show you the kind of places that you're in. So.
It's here, Frontera de Nacio Cooperative in Marca, Peru, that Sustainable Harvest launched its first RITS pilot in South America. RITS is short for Relationship Information Tracking System, and it provides tools to increase efficiency and traceability across the cotton supply chain. This suite of software applications includes RITS Producer to track coffee collection, RITS Ed for sharing instructional videos on best practices in coffee farming, and RITS Metrics, which will expedite the certification process by storing farmer surveys and offering critical reports.
We've designed the system because cooperatives have a lot of challenges in terms of record. RITS is a system that allows cooperatives to keep track of all the data they need to in their business operations. It allows the cooperative to better track information about coffee collected from farmers, the way that the coffee is processed within the cooperative, how it's stored and dried, and finally how it's milled and shipped to their customers. And we think that with a cloud-based system, it'll give the cooperatives the 21st century tools that they need to remain competitive about today.
Mi nombre es Jenny Colala Mesa. Trabajo en la cooperativa desde hace 10 años en el área de caja. Cuando un productor va con su documento de recogida de cerezo, yo le hago su documento para el pago. Y siempre el productor está preguntando, ya completé mi cuota, ¿cuánto me falta? Y no le podemos responder hasta completar la información en el sistema. Después de un mes, ya tenemos el reporte. Nosotros para poder obtener esa información inmediata necesitamos que esté el acopio que nosotros vamos recibiendo en pergamino y en cerezo esté en tiempo real.
At Frontera, they're using dozens of receipt books and forms to keep track of coffee collection and quality control. With RITS Producer, the cooperative can record that data in one place and be able to reference it from anywhere in the cooperative. Storing data in the cloud gives cooperatives the ability to track what's happening in the cooperative in multiple locations. And being able to look at real-time data online allows a leadership to know immediately when to start milling coffee, or when to collect coffee, or when the price of coffee has changed. It's a much more secure, reliable system, and can really become scalable as the cooperative grows in volume as well.
Para hacer el cálculo a quintales, lo hacen siempre con ese informe, ese factor. Siempre coincide. ¿Y qué se con ese documento? ¿Lo archiva o lo guarda? Ahorita no están llevando un registro de eso, pero sí les gustaría tenerlo. This transformative technology will allow the cooperative to achieve their dream, into, that is, to have information of each individual farmer that is member of Frontera de San Ignacio. And being able to use this information to do the reports for the certifications and the product harvest financiers.
La empresa tiene esa visión de realizar un sistema completo. Con esta tecnología que nos acaban de mostrar los iPhone, sería vital para recolectar esa información de cada productor.
Bueno, con respecto a RITS, parece una tecnología de punta, nos va a permitir un ahorro, pues por lo menos un 60-70%. Si antes era así en 3-4 meses, se puede realizar en un mes todo el trabajo y así se puede ahorrar la mano de obra y también tener información exacta para poder pedir la certificación orgánica.
We're making mobile educational technology for enriching people's lives. In this case, the technology is an iPad app to deliver video educational and training content to coffee farmers. Making the software for the iPad was an obvious choice because it's a really easy to access, easy to use, easy to move piece of hardware.
Y yo creo que el joven se sentiría un poco más motivado teniendo estas herramientas en la mano. Es una educación visual. Los productores más aprenden bien. y viendo sobre todo y aprendiendo de los productores o de organizaciones exitosas.
Challenges we had with each of them.
But I think a couple of points I want to make about our general strategy when it comes to technology and when it comes to mobile is it's part of the work that we do to support coffee co-ops. We're not saying every coffee farmer should have an iPad. I'm not sure that would be effective or really even practical. We're talking really about helping people who have work they're doing, helping them do it more effectively, giving them the tools they need to really compete in a sustainable way. What drives us to do this work, it's not just because we want the world to be better, but we want that. We want people to have sustainable livelihoods. It's because we see relationship coffee, a business model. The only way we're going to be a sustainable business is if we have a sustainable supply chain. So it's actually imperative that we work with everybody we buy coffee from to have sustainable livelihoods so we can keep buying and growing with them as we go. So I'd like to move into the 10 lessons that I'm going to share with you today. And I think you'll see some things in here that are big successes, some things that I think have been maybe failures. But what I hope, what I would sort of challenge each of you to do is to think about whether these are things that can apply to your work, whether you make apps or not. I think there's a lot of lessons I've learned personally just about working with other people and writing projects. So let's get started. Lesson one, get grounded. Become an informed anthropologist. So when we build apps to solve problems. And it's hard enough for me to build things for myself when I know what I'm trying to do. It's even more difficult when I'm trying to build an app for somebody who lives in a different country, speaks a different language, has a different culture, has a different job. And how do you approach that problem? How do you do it in a way that's going to be successful? I think it's really important basically to throw all the preconceptions you have out the window because they're probably wrong. You need to approach being an anthropologist really carefully looking and trying to understand how the people you're building the app with, your users, understand themselves and see their challenges and see their problems. Here's an example. So when I started working on the Ritz producer traceability app in Peru, I learned that in Peru they use this unit to track coffee called quintal. So rather than using kilograms, they use quintals. And I was sort of baffled by this because I learned that in every community, they have a different conversion rate. So in one place it's 55.2 kilograms, in one place it's 56, in another place it's 52. And I was thinking to myself, how can they get any work done if they can't even agree on what they're measuring, right? Well, actually, it turns out that they're very smart, surprise, surprise. Without getting into the nitty-gritty, basically coffee is a fruit, and the coffee bean that we roast and drink is the seed of that fruit. And different coffee varieties grown in different regions have a different ratio of fruit to seed in terms of weight. And what the quintals do is they actually approximate what's going to be left over once all of the fibers and fruit is gone, how much coffee you're actually going to have to sell. So what I was told was a unit of weight is actually a unit of yield, a unit that shows how much coffee is going to be there at the end. And so what I learned from that exploration was, first of all, don't take things for granted, but really that what I needed to track was not just weight, but yield. And there's lots of different ways of doing that. The other thing that really, I think, helped me as I navigated that one story is that I already had a background in coffee. So I already knew about how coffee was processed and what the steps were. And so I think if you're just an anthropologist and you don't know anything about the world where you're going into, you're going to have to spend a lot of time figuring out the basics. So being an anthropologist, but try to be an educator. Start learning what you can about the work is, but then be prepared to move on if you find out that you're wrong. Lesson two. The best way to encourage adoption is to build indispensable solutions. I don't know, I think this sounds maybe a little bit like common sense, but I think when you ask somebody to use something that you build, you're really asking people to change the way they do the work. You're changing status quo. You're saying, here is this great new tool, and you're going to try it, and you're going to love it. And the truth is that in our experience building apps for cooperatives, the folks that work there are so busy, and they're so hardworking, that unless they see crystal clear how useful your tool is, they're just not going to use it. It's like, so I'm a programmer, and I use a Vim. I don't know how many programmers we have in the room. But if my boss came to me one day and said, hey, I have this great new tool. It's going to make you so fast. You're going to be a better programmer. It's called Emacs. I would probably just want to leave, because I wouldn't want to give up that idea. Yeah. So it's about really understanding that people have reasons for using what they use and the processes that they have, but that if it's clear, they will switch. A couple stories that show how this doesn't work. We were doing a pilot in Peru and working with one of the managers of the co-op, and we had talked and he had said that he would do some testing for us, give us some feedback. A couple of weeks went by and he hadn't done that with the other. So we gave him a call and said, hey, what's going on? I haven't heard from you. He said, well, we love working with you, Sustainable Harvest. You know that we're one of your favorite suppliers, and I know this work is really important to you, so I'll do what's wrong. And that's very flattering for him to say, but what that told us is that we had failed. We didn't create a tool that had such an obvious benefit, but he wanted to do it. And if we're asking people to do extra work, we're becoming a chore. It means that we aren't meeting our goal of having impact and really helping people become more efficient. So we see that as a failure on us, not a failure on them. I think that when you're building apps for people who are in some difficult situations, that's a really important thing to keep in mind. So solve real problems and build solutions that are clearly solutions. Lesson three, trust is paramount. Help build it by having a stake in the game. In the communities where we work, there's a lot of money going in and a lot of work happening. So governments, NGOs, development organizations, groups like USAID are doing projects constantly in coffee. They're bringing in new technologies, they're bringing in new kinds of training. But one of the things you'll hear if you talk to people who've been recipients of these trainings is they won't always be very positive about it. They'll say, people came in with these great and ambitious ideas, and then they left, they ran out of money, or they didn't do what they said they were going to do. So we have to understand, just working with the people that have had that experience, that they're a little bit weary of working with you. They know that you might do that too. So you have to build trust. And I think the way that we've done that, that makes us sort of unique in this space, is because we have other relationships already. Because we buy coffee from these organizations, we already have a business relationship. If they go under, then we won't have coffee to sell. And if we go away, well, they can just stop selling us coffee. So we have some skin in the game too. And that's helped us really build trust, but it happens over a long period of time. By transacting business for many years, we're able to really work with people who might not otherwise want to work with. Lesson four, work with partners that are as passionate as you. Building software is an iterative process. There's twists and turns and bugs and new features and scope changes and platform busting and all kinds of stuff gets in the way. And as an engineer, I get frustrated sometimes. But if I think I get frustrated, think about how someone who's never been part of a software development project would feel. Someone who's maybe even never used a computer before. What's going to happen when their system goes down? You know, how are you going to be able to deal with that? So as you're embarking on a project, if it's something that's designed to create impact, it's really important to find the people that you can work with. And I'm not just talking about your staff or the people that are using the software. I'm talking about funders. We're really lucky to have worked with funders who've been really flexible with us as we change platforms or change scope. As we learn more about the situation on the ground. Tech consultants like Extreme right here in town, who've spoken here before, share a passion for education. Root Capital is one of our content providers for this, and we work with them in many, many ways. I think one of the ways and sort of stories that show this, how this can be really effective, is when we were working in northern Tanzania, training people who never used computers before to use a web application. We were really worried what would happen if we didn't work, they saw an error. And so what we did is we trained them to submit bug reports, basically, take screenshots and send us Skype chats. And what happened was that we got them. When things didn't work, we heard about it. And by empowering them to be part of the process, be part of the collaboration, we were able to really solve a lot of issues that we might not otherwise have known about. So I think you can be really optimistic if you're working with people who really see the mission and have a passion. Lesson 5. Choose your platforms carefully and push them to their limits. When we started building apps for Origin, we were starting in around 2008. It was really before we had much experience with tablets. They weren't really happening yet. And so we sort of started with a laptop, web app, kind of platform. And it was really, you know, for our company, it was what we were familiar with. It was really the only viable platform for us at the time. But you know, it worked pretty well. You know, we used MacBooks with 3G USB modems. Batteries were good when the power sort of cut out every once in a while. But laptops, we found, became quite difficult to train people to use. So if you've never used a computer before, what we found is it takes about 3 weeks of training to be able to use a computer and be able to use our about half an average. And that is the bare minimum of using a computer. I mean, it's not doing a lot of things that you want to do every day. But when iPads came out, when multi-touch devices started coming out, we sort of looked at this and said, well, would this work? Would this meet the needs that we have? And the answer has been a definite yes. We found that training with an iPad will take 3 days to get cover based on the same amount of knowledge. And not only that, but the people who are using them are a lot happier. And as a IT person, I'm much happier too, because I don't have to deal with the complexities of a laptop computer. It's much easier to manage an iPad because it's more compliant. So at the same time, they are able to harness the full power of a mobile device, like a built-in 3G modem, with GPS, with all the other great things that we love about mobile technologies. So, it's been a really interesting process, and the iPad sort of, as we've started using it and building tools for it, it's sort of inspired us to build other tools as well. So it's been a really interesting process. This is kind of a cool little couple videos. This is one of our trainers in Tanzania, and what he's saying here is, I'm going to show you a video I made on how to properly sort coffee. In this video, I discuss the problems found with our coffees after it's collected. When I show farmers this video, they understand me. Yeah, I think it's so interesting to watch him. I had a chance to meet him last fall when I was visiting Tanzania. And see how he uses the device, because he looks like anybody else using the device. And when working with laptops, I see a lot of scratched heads and confusion. So I think that said a lot to me. Here's another little video. Another trainer saying, you can do everything on the iPad. I can take a picture of a training and share the picture with all of our colleagues at Sustainable Harvest right away so that they learn what you're doing in the field. So push your platform to your limits. Lesson 6. Prepare yourself for surprises by practicing pessimistic engineering. So as I mentioned in the last slide, when we started building apps, we were building web apps. And the great thing about web apps is they're centralized on servers, you can control them, The not so great thing about web apps is that they don't work very well often. Now, of course, things are changing. There are some technologies that let apps built with web technologies work off of them. But the apps we were building weren't that way. These were traditional server-based web applications. And we thought, okay, we're going to go and build this app, track coffee. And we went out to various rural collection stations where we wanted to use the app. And we got plugged in our 3G modems, and it worked. Everything was fine. And so we figured, all right, we'll build this web app, and everything's good. They'll just log on online and update the information. But it wasn't that simple. What we discovered was a lot of this. On the left-hand side is the laptop that can't get a signal. And the right-hand side is the old way of doing it that they have to use. That's more effective than the laptop because they couldn't get online. It turns out that in any of the places where we were working, the internet was present, but very unreliable. So it would go down for 6-8 hours at a time. And you can't run a business like that. You need to be able to do things at the speed of the business. And these guys are really busy with getting maybe hundreds of coffee deliveries a day. So even worse, when we tried to expand these pilots to more locations, we discovered that the 5 collection stations we were working with were basically the 5 collection stations in Tanzania that had internet. And we realized that was really going to hold us back from doing more of this project. And this co-op really wanted, this is a co-op of 10,000 people with hundreds of collection stations, they wanted to use it for the whole thing. So what we realized was that our optimistic engineering decision, build a web app, actually in the long term, really restricted our ability to scale. So what I would suggest is that think about the worst case scenario of infrastructure, location, whatever it is for your context, and then think about whether it could be any worse, and that's what you should engineer it out for. The engineering side of me says, gosh, that's gonna trip the price of your project, if it has to work offline, and sync, and all these kinds of things, but it needs to work there, it needs to work there. So don't cheap out. Just sort of a little side comment though, another thing we discovered was that as we were trying to scale this program, many of the collection stations didn't have power. And luckily we were able to work with a funder to get solar panels for a lot of these groups. And the really cool thing about solar panels was, first of all, we engineered around the infrastructure problem in a decentralized way by bringing power from the sun. That's great. And we're bringing power to groups that didn't have this power before. And they partially invested in it themselves. One of the really interesting ways they decided to use this new power was to charge their members' cell phones, which you can sort of see on the right side there. Most farmers in Africa, at least where we work, do have cell phones. They have little feature phones. And they don't have power at home, so they have to take it to a shop or a corner store or something to actually get it charged. And that costs money. But by bringing it to the coffee co-op, where they're already a member, they can do it for free. So this technology that we brought for a really specific purpose, which was to work on and facilitate the project that we were doing, had this sort of unintentional benefit as well, which was to strengthen the community around the school, to bring people in, to help people sort of feel more connected and to provide them a service. So this can happen, and that's pretty cool. Lesson 7, let users surprise and inspire you. It's been really fun and really gratifying to work with the people I've had a chance to work with in Coffee Co-ops. People have very wide levels of experience with technology. Some people use computers, some people have never used one before. But everybody wants to learn. Everybody sees these things and wants to be able to use them to solve their problems. And so just the motivation and the effort that people put into their work is really inspiring to me. And what it really just takes is your listening ability. Sometimes a couple offhand comments will turn into a major new solution or even a new path. Somebody saying something like, well, you're tracking the coffee that farmers are bringing. Could you track the money that I'm paying them as well? And that turned into a large solution where we actually brought receipt printers, and we're able to sort of provide a two-way communication between farmers and this organization to help strengthen the battle. It's really great to hear responses to surveys that say things like, you know, I feel up to date and modern now. Technology is great. You know, we're so glad we have this because now we don't feel like we're you know, backwards farmers. That's very interesting. But this is my favorite story of all. This is a woman named Mama Grace, and she's one of our community trainers in northern Tanzania. And like all of our trainers, she was issued an iPad, and we spent sort of a day in the office teaching her how to play videos and share them with her peers. And in a follow-up training, she came into the office and she said, hey, look what I have. And it turned out that she had actually figured out on her own how to record a video of the iPad. They had somebody film her doing the training, showing how to take care of a coffee tree. The iPad was in English. She doesn't speak English. She speaks Swahili and probably a tribal language. So we were just sort of stumped. And we realized that, well, what we thought we were doing was to build an app to share industry best practices. You know, because you know, we'll talk to the experts and record a video, and we'll record, you know, a handbook, and we'll have all this stuff, and we'll bring it to them. But what this told us was that's not really necessarily the right way of doing it. Realize that all of these community trainers have such a wealth of knowledge. They don't just have global, they have local knowledge. They really understand the context. So what we want to be able to do is to facilitate people like Mama Grace to share her videos out in our community. And we're still working on that sort of functionality, but boy, that was an inspiring day when we got this thing about. Lesson 8. Problems are best solved with creativity, collaboration, and transparency. So at this point, I think you're probably getting the picture that the projects we've been working on are complicated. They have a lot of little moving pieces, a lot of people to organize, a lot of trainings. And sometimes things don't go so well. But it's really important when you do have setbacks to be really open about it and really collaborative. Because your best resources are really everybody else you're working with. You have a stake. So in this risk producer project, this is the 2-year grant that we were doing in Tanzania with the laptops and the coffee collection. We were nearing the end of the project. We had gone through these issues of infrastructure, the internet going down, power going down. And we realized that because of these challenges, because of sort of the state of the app as it had been created, it really wasn't a sustainable project. It really was not gonna succeed. We got pretty scared and actually had like really emotional thinking because this was like something that really sort of poured our heart and soul into. We weren't sure what to do. We were running out of money and running out of time. So we were really open about that. We said, here's the situation. Here's how much it costs to, you know, run the servers. Here's how much it costs to pay for the internet. Here's how much, you know, time are we going to do? What can we do? How flexible can we be? And the thing that got sort of most in my gut was talking to the folks using the system saying things like, if this goes away, farmers won't trust us anymore. We'll lose all of our credibility. We won't have enough money to pay for it. So I was pretty scared. But what we were able to do in talking with people, doing a lot of brainstorming, was actually to create a system that in many ways is better than the one that we had spent so much time building. Without getting into too many of the details, basically we built a system based on Excel and Dropbox, and we worked completely offline, let the groups track the most important data that they needed to, same when they get online, still print off receipts and do all the other things we do. We had to give up on some of our more aspirational features, like connecting quality, blending the chain with inputs and connecting. Those were things that they weren't using that much anymore. So by really looking and talking and understanding what needs were the most important, we were able to come up with a solution that actually was pretty good. In some ways was better because it didn't rely on it. And we couldn't have done that if we had to have used the collaborative process. So that sort of goes into this one as well. Have clear goals for success. Starting over doesn't actually necessarily mean failure. Sometimes you've learned the lessons you had to learn to build the right system. And when you're passionate about something, you have a lot of skin in the game, and you've put a lot of effort into it, it's disheartening when it doesn't work. But if you have clear goals for success, you can be more realistic about what you achieve. Having metrics is a really good way of doing that. So for training systems, I'm recording every time a trial is conducted. This is a sort of a list of some of the trainings that our community trainers in Tanzania. And this is a slide that I actually got a couple days ago from somebody who was visiting our office in Moshi. And this is at one of the washing stations, they're using the new system. Our product finished a couple months ago, and they're using it. So when I see things like that, I realize we actually have built a sustainable system. And the last lesson, make sustainability your top priority by building an MSP, not an MVP. What do I mean by that? In our projects, we're trying to do more than just build apps. We're really trying to create an impact. We're trying to change the way that people are doing their jobs. We're trying to empower them to be more efficient, to be more connected, to be more traceable. But we've asked people to trust us and to rely on the tools that we've built. I think, a minimum viable product, which is sort of this, you know, startup buzzword, right? Building the minimum thing you need to build to have people use it. I think that's not enough in these communities, because if I go away, I can, you know, the worst thing that will happen to me is I'll lose my job, and I can go get another one. But if an app that the community is building livelihood around goes down, then the consequences can be disastrous. And I feel like I have a personal responsibility for that. I think that my company has a responsibility for that as well. So I would challenge you when you're building a tool and deciding on functionality you should have to think about the minimum sustainable project. Think about the minimum that an app needs to be for it to continue to perpetuate itself after you're long gone. It's hard, I don't know necessarily what that would mean in your case, but that's definitely what I aspire to do. These organizations are going to exist whether or not your app does. And you know, when we think about the future of coffee, we bring it back to sort of sustainable harvest and the relationship coffee model, we know that we need to think about the future. And I love this photo because it's showing the farmer trying out the iPad for the first time. All of a sudden watches on. And when it really comes down to it, the work that we're trying to do with technology and training and everything that we do, we're really thinking about the sun. Because in order for growing coffee to be a viable, sustainable business, we can't just be thinking about what farmers are going to do today. We have to be thinking about what's going to be happening in the future. Is he going to move to a city because that's where the jobs are? Or are we going to build tools that make farming a respectable, sustainable living? And I don't know what's going to happen, but I sure hope that we can continue to invest in these communities and strengthen them so that it can be sustainable. And I think that if you do that, you might even get a little bit of love back. So, thank you.
Okay, so if you have questions, I'll come around with the mic.
Hey, I'm just curious, are there any stories you have about maybe like apprehension from villages you visited, like who really didn't want us coming into their lifestyle?
The truth is that people are, we're actually, in my experience, pretty open to the kinds of things that we're doing. I think, in a practical sense, yes. Here's kind of a little story. We were doing a data tracking pilot in Peru, and we're using this sort of iPad-based form tool. So you tap it, you type in information, and it saves it to the mobile device that syncs it up to the cloud, we have a cloud connection. And after doing this pilot for a while, we realized that the main surveyor was actually printing off all the forms, filling them in with pencil and paper, and then putting it into the iPad later. Because he didn't really trust that by putting it in the iPad, it would actually save. And I don't blame him. I mean, I definitely didn't work. That's not impossible for him. But to him, if he loses a day at work, it could have pretty severe consequences. But what it took was us to spend a little bit more time showing him how the system worked so he could understand what was going on. And after that, once he sort of put the pieces together, he adopted it pretty easily. So I think it's, in my experience, it's more of those kinds of stories than in just saying, like, these people haven't gotten where they are by being totally risk-averse. They're smart. There's an advantage to have.
You mentioned being an informed anthropologist with your field, but how did that work? Did you, like, in practicality, did you work with like researchers or interpreters when you were there? And, what did that look like, getting across the culture with language barriers and all the research?
For sure, that's a great question. I think the work that the sort of larger answer to that question is that's why Sustainable Harvest has offices in Origin. That's why we work really closely, my coworkers are folks that come from coffee communities that have, you know, degrees in agronomy that can actually serve as those translators. So the nice thing is I've actually been able to lean on my coworkers to help that translation, both in terms of language and in terms of context. But yeah, I think that that's what I'd say. Ask a lot of questions. A lot of questions. I think one of the most interesting trips I've been on was in Peru, the one that the video filmed. Basically, what I did on a 4-day trip was we went to this cooperative, Frontera, and starting at the time when a farmer brings his coffee to the co-op, I said, okay, so the farmer walks up, what do you do? And then what do you do next? And what do you write down? And then what decisions do you make next? So I basically conducted sort of a detailed business analysis of this organization. And you know, I didn't learn everything there was to learn, but by sometimes focusing on the minute details, you're able to sort of see a larger picture as well. So it takes attacking these problems for it to make sense.
In that hostile environment, what was the average life expectancy of an iPad?
So in the last couple years, it's a great question. It's a really important question because we need to think about what will be sustainable. We've been using iPads for about 2 years, and we haven't had problems yet. What we found, interestingly, but not surprisingly, is that if these tools are really valued by the people who own them, they'll take care of them. I mean, coffee co-ops are used to dealing with pretty large sums of money. Each sort of contract, sort of basic unit of transaction, coffee is a shipping container, and its value is around $120,000. So these groups are dealing with sometimes multi-million dollar loans, and they know how to take care of equipment. And so what we found is because these tools are so critical, they feel that they're so important to their work, they will store them in safes. They will use, you know, will supply them with cases to make sure that they're taken care of. But because iPads have no moving parts, because they don't require a lot of maintenance, it also is in some ways a pretty rugged device as well. So people take care of them, and just by virtue of the devices, we have.
I was wondering if you could speak to designing for various degrees of literacy and maybe different cultural customizations for the different locations.
Sure. Yeah, I think one of the biggest decisions that we made pretty early on building these tools was to use as many visual-based designs as possible, focusing less on text and language and more on visual cues. use, which, you know, when it comes to coffee, coffee's grown all over the world, and people speak lots of different languages, but the things generally look pretty similar. So we rely on a lot of icons and those sorts of things. But I think every time we introduce technology, it does require a fair amount of training. So, you know, it's like the floppy disk, same icon, right? If you've never seen a floppy disk, how would you know that the icon? There's some cases where there's not a whole lot we can do other than really explain this is how it works, and this is what the metaphor is, and this is what it does. I will say that it's really nice to have a multilingual staff. I think of 40 people, we speak 20 languages, including some native languages in Mexico and elsewhere. So my coworkers in Tanzania are really tired of me sending them long text for them to translate and explain. Yeah.
Thanks, Ezra. That was great. I had a question. Sort of, I was confused at the end about when you were talking about the minimally sustainable product, and you were showing sort of laptops at the end. Are there iPads out in the field? Were those like two different brands or two different projects? Or what is actually out in use right now? Is it a mixture of iPads and laptops?
It's a mixture of laptops, iPhones, and iPads. Because our grants and our projects are sort of on a 2 to 3 year spectrum, the device landscape changes 3 or 4 times within that time frame. So we sort of picked what was best at the time, but we can't go upgrade every 6 months. We just don't have the funding to do that. So we started with laptops. We tried to transition to iPhones and found it to be only marginally successful because of the form factor and the cost, because they're actually quite expensive when you buy them locked or get them alone. And we basically at this point transitioned to all our new projects focusing primarily on.
Your system brought a lot of efficiency to the business processes. Typically, that means that you can do a lot more with fewer people. That sometimes translates into people losing their jobs. Did that happen over there? If it did, how did people react to it?
A really, really important question. What we've found with the organizations we work with is that generally people are overworked, not underworked. So oftentimes, for instance, the person that's managing coffee collection at a rural collection station in Tanzania is also a farmer. So if he's actually spending less time in the co-op, and the co-op becomes more efficient, he can spend more of his time taking care of himself, taking care of his family. So if he had less work to do, that would actually be a positive. Because these are cooperatives that we're working with, a lot of this sort of HR decisions are made in the collective. And so it is about trying to figure out how to make these organizations as efficient as possible. None of these things have made a big enough impact, I'll be completely honest, to put anybody out. I have not heard about that one bit. And I haven't even heard that raised by the folks we've been talking about as a concern. But I think that if these products were to become more successful, that's something we really have to deal with. And we have to deal with it as a team. We have to talk with the organizations we're working with and be really open and figure out what makes the most sense for them. I don't think I can say it for sure.
Hi, I was wondering, you said it was about a 3-day learning curve for these groups, and I'm wondering if you could speak to either surprises or sort of an outline of some of the things you encountered in that 3-day cycle.
Sure. Yeah, well, unfortunately, I wasn't conducting those trainings. Those were my very hardworking colleagues at Origin that those trainings. So I don't really have any good stories to tell. But what I will say is that when you don't, there's something about multi-touch and having a tactile, sort of a touch, have a media response that has really resonated with people. One of the most interesting things, this is a maybe better example. I was in Peru, and I brought the iPad, and I was showing some folks who've never seen one before. Within about 20 or 30 seconds, they could use the Photos app and see how to swipe between photos and zoom in and zoom out. And the really cool thing to witness is when people discover those gestures on their own, because they sort of make intuitive sense. It's really hard because I have this preconceived notion of how a mouse works and how a desktop works. But to see someone sort of discover that on their own makes me think that computing is moving in the right direction.
Now that you've, looks like we've gotten pretty far down the road with this mobile app system, is there plans to market it to other coffee producers? Seems to me like it's a very valuable tool that would have a lot of value to other people who don't have it.
Yeah, I think the way that we've seen our technology development is the same way we see all the other trainings and work we do in Origin. And that is that we focus on our suppliers. When you work with us and you sell us coffee, this is sort of one of the added benefits that you get. And we do this because we've invested in long-term relationships with these organizations, and we really want to see them succeed. So I would never say we would say no to somebody we don't already work with, but that's really where our priorities lie. The expensive part about this technology is not so much the technology that's relatively inexpensive, it's the training and project management, the human costs that go into making it function and work. And so it would require a pretty substantial amount of cash just to expand it. And the problem with these tools that we've developed is that we've developed them for people who don't have the cash to spend. So we're still looking, trying to look creatively at how we can do that, because I think that is our goal, is to bring these kinds of tools to the entire coffee supply chain, maybe even to other supply chains as well.
As I understand it, this is more for the cooperative side of things, the higher level side of the whole system. Are you looking at going deeper into the supply chain and working with farmers? I understand that cellular technology and SMS is really huge all the way down to the farm level. So what are you thinking in that?
Yeah, we're certainly interested. We haven't really gotten that far yet. But we were talking before the talk began about how in Kenya, one of the technologies that's had widespread adoption is this called M-Pesa, which is basically a mobile bank. So you have a bank account balance that's tied to your cell phone. And it's basically a text message away to transfer it to anybody in the world that has the system. And you can just take your phone into any shop where you can buy, where you can top up your phone and get that money out of the system. So it's really brought banking to a whole new group of people that have never been able to have a bank before. So it would make a lot of sense, for instance, to tie in farmer payments with our system. That's a really clear way we can go. We have been able to. I think we're really interested in that. I think SMS is still sort of the key technology in that area. We've had some conversations with folks that are doing that kind of work. We're not there, but we'd like to.
Cool.
Very cool app. Does the applications that you've developed, how's it impacted your margins on the coffee?
Most of the tools that you've seen here today are tools that we've built with our own money, but the implementation of the tools, we've often been able to offset with grant money. So all of the training work and all of the project management work for bringing this out to Tanzania, for instance, has been funded by grants. So that's money we wouldn't have if we didn't have these, tools. So by and large, it hasn't upset our margin or changed our margin that much. We look very creatively to find funding for these projects. We're a completely bootstrapped company. We have no outside investment. So we have to be very careful about how we choose to invest our money.
Amazing work. You spoke a lot about how you're enabling co-ops to better coordinate their lending activities. But
what implications does this application have for your actual business at home? Are you able to get faster feeds on what coffee is selling? I understand the last couple of years a certain strain of coffee wasn't able to be sold for certain reasons. Were you able to get that kind of information faster, or would you be able to get that kind of information faster if this application was deployed to all those fields?
Absolutely. There's a huge information gap right now between what's happening at origin, where coffee's grown, and what we're able to see here in the world. And that was the original idea behind having offices in these countries. That was sort of version 1.0. And we see the next generation of growth being based off of technology solutions that help help us and help cooperatives and help roasters identify and diagnose problems before we know about it. A couple examples of things that maybe could be solved with technology. In Nicaragua this year, they had very large rains that were unseasonable. One of the key steps in processing coffee for roasting is to dry it out. Take the fruit and the seeds sort of get dry out outside. But when it rains, that coffee can't dry. And when it can't dry, it gets moldy. And when it gets moldy, roasters don't want it. So we've been working really closely with this group that we buy a significant amount of coffee from. And they're basically going to go bankrupt this year because of this climate change. And if we had known about this earlier, we might have been able to work with them to find some other places where the coffee could be dried, or bring in some mechanical dryers or things. But what we didn't know until sort of too late. So part of it is a communication issue, but I think there's a lot of opportunity for technology to come into place.
My question is sort of a follow-on to the last one. You mentioned the roasting process and getting information there. How has this sort of information you gathered, how has that affected your ultimate consumers, the Whole Foods and the Ben & Jerry's and so forth, in terms of their information, what they know, and sort of also the relationship with the farmer as well, if there's been any sort of interplay there?
Really good question. By and large, they're not very interested. And that's disappointing to me, because I have this vision of the future where you've tracked the coffees from the time it's grown, collected into a co-op, goes to an importer, gets onto a shelf, you scan it with your phone, and it shows you the exact farmers that grew the coffee. Because that's totally possible. But the problem is that every step in the way, people don't want to give up that information. And coffee roasters buy coffee from all kinds of different importers, and so they can't have one coffee that has this level of detail and the other coffee which is just sort of a black box. So I think if consumers asked for more information about the coffee that they buy, roasters would come to organizations like mine and say, hey, give us this information. We'll pay you for it. They won't pay us for it now. So I think that is the future. I think we're going to, we live in Portland, right? Everybody wants to know where their food comes from. We all go to the farmers, and we all watch Portland deal with the chicken, right? And I think it's hyperbolic, but it also really appeals to my sense of community, my sense of connectedness, and wanting to make sure that the decisions I'm making are affecting the world positively. There's not so much difference between calling the chicken and Pedro the coffee farmer. It's just that there's not information, there's no dossier you can print out, there's too many steps under the way. That's a problem technology is solving. So if consumers ask for it, why?
You said in the video, a farmer explained that it helped the app actually helped them get organic certification. That's one question I want to ask. And another is, you said something about enabling this technology enabling you to eliminate foreign offices and kind of fill that information gap about making a foreign office. Do you think it would be possible for NGOs and other people or other government organizations who actually have foreign offices to eliminate those kinds of mediators and provide this technology to them to actually fill that information gap?
I'll take your second question first. I think that it there's nothing like having boots on the ground. There's nothing like having real human relationships with people and getting to know face to face. That's, I think that's never going to go away from our business, and I hope it never does, because when you meet face to face, you can really deal with issues like that. Technology can sometimes facilitate great conversations, but sometimes you just need to have face to face meetings. So I think in the long term, I hope technology continues to help us be more connected and to help our sort of day-to-day conversations be more efficient, but I don't think it should replace real meetings. Not in this kind of way. What was your first question again?
How does the app help people get organic
certification? Oh, certification. Certification is an interesting can of worms. There's lots of certifications, fair trade, organic boots, there's lots of different certified organizations. It's all kind of a mess, and basically co-ops spend an incredible amount of man hours in doing internal audits, surveys, controls. Every year they have to get certified and audited by external certifiers and have certification. And so what we're aspiring to do, say we're not doing yet, is to give co-ops the ability to collect all of the information they need to collect for these disparate groups at once, so they don't have to do it once for fair trade, once for organic, once for their bank loans, once for their social loans. It's a lot of data, there's a lot of power consolidated in different places, and everyone wants to work together, but I think in our vision, we have something like a common app that we have for colleges, but for certifications, where there's the base information that everybody fills out all the time, and there's these sort of addendum that each certifier would add to it, but we still have a lot of sort of coalition building to be able to make that. People are pretty tied to their systems.
I think that's it. This was a really great, Ezra. Thank you a lot. And we'll see you again, I think, on August 27th. Thanks for coming.